Hello, peeps, and welcome back to How the Heck Do I, Gregtech 103. So, in Gregtech 101, we covered the basic processing machines, all of the basic stuff that Gregtech adds, as well as the Bronze Age and the single-unit generators. In 102, we covered inventory management, automation, and redstone. In episode 3, we are going to cover the multi-block generators. We're going to cover the thermal boiler, the steam turbine, the large gas turbine, and the fusion reactor. Now, I'm going to show you how to build them, I'm going to show you how to make them work together, and we're also going to compare them against existing Gregtech and industrial craft technology so that you guys know which ones are best for which situations, so that you have some pros and cons on them. So, let's go ahead and get started with the thermal boiler. The thermal boiler is a multi-block. It is made with reinforced casings. You'll need one thermal boiler block. And you'll need some of these hatches. You'll need two input hatches, two output hatches, and one maintenance hatch. There's also a dynamo hatch, we'll be using that in a little bit. There's a muffler hatch, which we'll be using quite a bit later. There's also this energy hatch, which I really don't know exactly what it does. I haven't noticed that it's used for any of the generators. So, whatever. Anyway, let's go ahead and start building the thermal boiler. You start out with a ring of reinforced casings. Just like that. All right? You need a thermal boiler right there. You need a maintenance hatch. You will need two output hatches. And you will need two input hatches. Just like that. After you get these set, you're going to want to modify the output hatches to tell them exactly what they are allowed to take for you. You do this with a screwdriver. On this output hatch, we're going to tell you that you are allowed to output steam. On this side, you are allowed to output only items. We're going to need some pump modules. We're going to need some conveyor modules. Conveyor module on this side. Pump module on this side. We're also going to need, we're also going to need to input water and lava into this thing. We're going to do water from the top, and you can use any sort of water supply you want. You can use aqueous accumulators, you can use Gregtech water tanks, you can use pretty much anything you want, but there is a module that I haven't shown you yet called drain, which collects liquids and rain. If you put a drain on top of an input hatch, it's going to modify it to look like that. Then if you get some stone and some water and make yourself a little infinite water source on top of this, just like so, you're going to see that the input hatch will pull in the water blocks. And this is actually going to input plenty of water to handle everything. And I apologize in advance if you guys can hear the cats yelling in the background. I tried 3 times to record this last night and couldn't do it because of the cats. I have resolved that I'm not going to interrupt my recording tonight. I might cut out and re-record some sections, but this video is coming out tonight, come hell or high water. Alright, so we have the water going in the top. We need to put lava into the bottom. We're going to do that with some large tungsten steel fluid pipes. We're going to get a quantum tank, which we're going to put right here. A pump module on the side of the quantum tank. If you're going to use a large tungsten, if you're going to use like a regular Railcraft tank or something like that, you have to put the pump module on the fluid pipe here. You can also use liquid ducts or whatever, but I just prefer using the Gregtech stuff for powering these things because the Gregtech stuff has a lot more throughput. And Becca just got attacked by a cat in the background. We're also going to need to attach a fluid pipe off of this. This is where we're going to store our steam. We need to connect an item pipe. We're going to use a platinum item pipe. We're going to put that off of here. We're going to put that into a diamond chest. You can also just put this straight into an ME system or, you know, whatever you want. Where's the diamond chest? I'm blind. There it is. We're going to put that there, and we're going to give our quantum tank here some lava to work with. We're going to do that by means of a creative tank. And we need a bucket of lava. Put down a fluid pipe. Put the creative tank down on top of that. Make it a lava tank. And set it to output. That's going to feed plenty of lava into our quantum tank here, which is going to get sucked into our thermal boiler over here. So, what does the thermal boiler do? Well, it takes water and lava and it turns it into steam and items. Let's go ahead and load a blank configuration here. And I'm getting a lot of lag all of a sudden. There we go. Now it's better. And now I'm dropping again. Anyway, if we access the thermal boiler pour here, we're going to see there's a bunch of stuff wrong. It says pipe is loose, screws are missing, something is stuck, platings are dented, circuitry's burned out. That doesn't belong there. Well, it could also potentially say incomplete structure, which it will if there's an incomplete structure. But since we built it correctly, it's not going to say that. Each one of these problems is solved by a different Gregtech tool. Pipe is loose is solved by a wrench. Screws are missing is solved by a screwdriver. Something is stuck is solved by a rubber hammer. Platings are dented is solved by a metal hammer of some sort. Circuitry is burned out is solved by a soldering iron and some sort of solder, either tin or lead. They both do exactly the same job. Tin lasts longer. And that doesn't belong there is solved with a crowbar. However, there's also this handy-dandy Braintech Aerospace Advanced Reinforced Duct Tape FAL-84, which will also work. You can come back here, and you access the maintenance hatch here, and then you pick up your tools and you click them in here to repair them, or to repair the problems, or you can just take a piece of duct tape, pop it on there, but we'll save the duct tape for later. Let's take ourselves out of creative mode so you guys can see that the tools are going to take a slight little bit of damage when you do this. And that is going to solve all of our problems. If we come over here now, this is going to say hit with a rubber hammer to restart the machine if it doesn't start. Give it a whack with the rubber hammer, and machine processing is enabled. It is now going to pull water and lava. And it's going to create a rather absurd amount of steam. And it's also going to create for us obsidian, which is pretty cool. Now, let's go ahead and turn this off for a second. And we're going to get ourselves another item. If you notice when I interface with this, there's this little slot up here. If you get a lava filter and put it in that slot and then turn it on again, it's going to start filtering the lava to get some of the impurities out. What impurities? Well, silver, or not silver, tin, and you can get copper out of this, you can get electrum out of this. Copper seems to be pretty common, tin seems to be relatively common, electrum's pretty rare. Obsidian is extremely common. So, you're burning off lava and water to get steam, obsidian, and some metals. Upsides to this. It produces a ridiculous amount of steam. By comparison, the small coal boiler produces 125 millibuckets of steam per second. The high pressure coal boiler produces 300 millibuckets of steam per second. And the thermal boiler, this bad boy here, produces 16,000 millibuckets of steam per second. 16 full buckets. Ridiculous amount. By comparison, a Railcraft large steel high-pressure steam boiler produces about 10 buckets a second. So, this thing is more powerful even than that. This thing, if you need a lot of steam for something, this is a good way to go. However, there is a downside. That downside comes if we break this fluid pipe here, and we take a look at this, it is going to use about 2 buckets of lava every second. So this thing chews through lava like nobody's business. It's not even funny how much lava this thing goes through. So, bear in mind, lots of steam, but lots of lava. If you have a way to produce 2 buckets of lava a second reliably, this thing makes a pretty good source of steam. But is it worth it? You be the judge. Okay, we got some electrum in here now, we got some tin, we got some copper, so we're doing good. Let's go ahead and shut this thing off. And let's tear some of this down. We're going to tear pretty much the whole thing apart, because I'm getting some lag from something in here, and I don't like that. So we're gonna just kill the entire build here real quick. We'll just start out with a... Oh, hello. We'll start out with a brand new, fresh landscape. There we go. And load blank, and we're good. Alright, so, the second thing we're going to talk about is the large steam boiler. And I'm still at 30 frames per second, and I just shot back up to 100. There's something in this area that seems to be causing me trouble. Let's fly off this way a little bit before we continue. Whatever, that's good enough. Okay, we're going to do the steam boiler next. This uses standard casings, one steam turbine block, and some input hatches, some output hatches, a maintenance hatch, and a dynamo hatch. You're going to build a 3x4x3, kind of the same way we built the other one. On one side, you're going to put the steam turbine, and take a look at that, isn't that cool? On the other side, you're going to put the dynamo. This is where the energy is going to come out. You need two inputs, at least two inputs. You'll need at least one output and at least one maintenance hatch. Now, I say at least two inputs because, well, you have to supply this thing with 1,600 liters of steam per tick. You have to supply this thing with 32 buckets of steam a second. That's a ridiculous amount of steam. So if you're going to do this with a steam boiler or these turbines, you are probably going to need 2, maybe 3 input hatches in order to supply the amount of steam this thing is going to need, unless you do it a certain way. And I saw this in someone else's video spotlight, so I can't take full credit for this. But if you get the thermal boiler, remember that the thermal boiler puts out 16 buckets of steam a second? This thing eats 32? Yeah, so 2 steams will power this thing at full capacity, won't it? We're going to build the housing for our 2 thermal boilers. Here we are going to use an aqueous accumulator. So we're going to do the input for the water on the bottom. Here is our input hatch. Here is an input hatch. And we're going to do an aqueous accumulator. right here. That's going to allow us to produce plenty of water to supply this thing. And we can just use fluid duct for this. Put a fluid duct up there, and just like that, and just like that. That's going to supply plenty of water for this thing. Close this up, we don't have to worry about underneath here anymore. Okay, we also need to supply lava. It's probably going to be easiest to do this from one of the sides. We're going to do it from the back. So we need another input hatch on the back. Just like that. And we're going to put the lava in a few seconds here. We need an output hatch, which we're going to put right here. Let's see. Nope, we need a thermal boiler there. So we're going to put the thermal boiler there and the thermal boiler there. We're going to put output hatches here. In here. And now the last output hatch is going to be put facing this. However, if we do that, we're not going to be able to put the pump module on in order to be able to output this into the thermal here, are we? So we have to do it now. We're going to put an output hatch right here and one right there. We're going to get our screwdriver and our pump modules. We're going to tell this one is only allowed to output steam. This one's only allowed to output steam. Pump module, pump module. Standard casing, standard casing. We're not going to be able to access that anyway, so there's no point in trying to put anything there. Standard casing there. And here we're going to have our input hatches. Input hatch, input hatch. Standard casing. Standard casing. Or, nope, we want an output hatch, because this thing actually outputs steam. Water. Output hatch, and a maintenance hatch. We're also going to put a maintenance hatch here. We're going to put a maintenance hatch here. Okay? Let's get our tungsten steel fluid pipes back. We're going to run those along the ground here. We're going to put our quantum tank. We're going to put our quantum tank there, pump module on it. Wow. Yeah, not a happy kitty in the background. Okay, creative tank, full of lava, set to output. It's going to fill this quantum tank, and these fluid pipes are going to fill the thermal boilers. On the dynamo hatch here, we're going to put an AESU. Right there. Okay? Good. Now, all we have to do, well, we want to put a conveyor module on top of here. Or no, it's not a conveyor module. We need a pump module on there. And we're just going to put a quantum tank on it. We need our conveyor module there. Our conveyor module there. We're going to need our platinum item pipe.
Sound resumed. Oh. Sound muted.
We need our diamond chest. Right there. item pipe going into it. Same thing over here. And the last thing we need is we need a turbine. There are 5 different turbines that are added by Gregtech. The bronze turbine at 60% efficiency, the steel is 80%, the tungsten steel is 90% but has the most durability. Ugh. The magnesium is 100%. The carbon is 125%, but it has the lowest durability. This thing breaks really quickly. And if a turbine breaks while the thing is running, it explodes. So, yeah. You don't want to use carbon unless you're going to be monitoring it pretty frequently. So we're going to use a magnesium. And you can see, pipe is loose, screws are missing, blah, blah, blah. Same thing here. We don't feel like messing with all of the stuff here, so we're just going to use some good old-fashioned duct tape. You can see, even get a nice little graphic of duct tape on the maintenance hatch. Duct tape. Duct tape. And, by the way, yes, you actually can make duct tape now. Raw carbon, mesh, sticky resin, and rubber. So, everything is ready. All we have to do is give this thing a whack with a rubber hammer. There's one going, there's two going, and our turbine is going. Now, it's going to stutter a little bit when it's just getting started, because this thing has to heat up a little bit, and this thing has to heat up a little bit, but before long, it is running perfectly. So, this thing is now outputting 800 EU per tick. It's burning off 32 buckets of steam every second, which is provided by our thermal boilers. These, in exchange, are burning off 4 buckets of lava a second. So you're trading 4 buckets of lava every second to get 800 EU per tick. That sounds like a really good exchange rate, but let me cover a couple of things first. Now, pros to this. It looks really cool, and you do get the side effect of getting the items out of these. So if you need a good, if you need a really good source of obsidian, you can also throw the filters in here and get a good source of copper and tin and all that. If you need that, it's great, especially if you can provide 4 buckets of lava a second without blinking. It is also fairly compact, and I mean, you gotta admit, there's the cool factor here, right? However, here's the downside. Gregtech adds a device called a thermal generator. It's this thing right here. Max EU per pulse out is 24. That means 34 geothermal generators produces the same amount as this. You don't get the side effect, but you get the same amount of EU, and it uses far less lava. 34 geothermals running at once won't even use a bucket of lava a second. So this thing is very cool looking. It's not efficient at all. So, take it for what it's worth. If you want something that looks really awesome to fit in your base, by all means, go ahead. If you need a good source of, well, water and obsidian, and you can supply all of that stuff, then sure, why not? But if you're looking for the most EU per tick efficiency out of your lava, go geothermal. Don't even look back. Alright, so that is the large steam boiler, or the large steam turbine. The next thing we're going to cover is going to be the gas turbine. The large gas turbine says it's about 42 small gas turbines worth. That's actually not true, but we'll get to that in a little bit. This one uses the reinforced casings again. You still need the hatches. You'll need some input hatches, you'll need some output hatches, you'll need a maintenance hatch, a dynamo hatch, and this one you need the muffler hatch as well. This one you can go ahead and fill the bottom in, you won't need it. On one side, the large gas turbine. On the opposite side, the dynamo. On one side, an output hatch. On one side, an input hatch. We're also going to put the maintenance hatch on this side Fill this in with casing. Fill this in with a casing. And then up here we're going to put our muffler hatch. As far as I know, the muffler hatch cannot be in the front of the machine. It has to be towards the back of the machine. So we're going to put the muffler hatch right there. If we right-click this, we don't get the complete structure message, so we know it's fixed. We'll get our handy-dandy duct tape. Not in the dynamo. We'll duct tape the maintenance hatch. And this machine consumes methane. So, we're going to get ourselves a quantum tank. We're going to get ourselves the tungsten steel pipe. The pump module. Gonna get ourselves another creative tank. Get ourselves a can of methane to program the tank for methane. Get ourselves a crescent hammer. Set this to output mode. And we'll start. Well, I don't want to do that, but whatever. We'll start filling this thing with some methane. Over here, we'll put a pump module on there, out to a quantum tank. Still need the turbine. Again, we're going to use a magnolium turbine. And give it a whack with a rubber hammer to start it. Oh, we need an AESU on the back. Alright, so, let's get this thing running and see how it works. Give it a whack. Machine processing is enabled. Running perfectly. We're pulling out methane. And we are producing tons of power. This machine outputs, apparently, nothing. Okay. Could have sworn this thing output water, but whatever. So, we are burning off methane to produce 1,000 EU per tick. That's right, this thing produces 1,000 EU a tick. Holy crap. That's a lot of power. Now, the upsides. It's small, it's relatively compact, and it burns methane. And there really isn't much else used for methane. It also looks really cool. The downside. It does require occasional maintenance. These things do not last forever. If this thing runs out of durability while it's in here, it will blow up, so bear that in mind. These things do occasionally break down, in which case you'll have to come over here to the maintenance hatch and repair it with the appropriate tool. But how does it compare to the gas turbines? Well, the gas turbine that's added by Gregtech puts out 16 EU per tick. That means it takes 63 gas turbines to equal one large gas turbine. Okay, well, these things are, like, pretty expensive. It takes two windmills, some reinforced glass, some Invar aluminum plating. So yeah, 63 of these things would actually be a pretty big underdoing, and you'd have to have a pretty large amount of your plant assigned to it. So, yeah, space-wise, it's definitely worth it. Resource-wise, it's worth it. But how are we doing on efficiency? Well, 63 gas turbines is going to burn one bucket of methane about every 1.5 seconds. This thing is going to burn one bucket of methane about every 2 seconds, 2.1. So this thing actually isn't that much more inefficient than the gas turbines. It does require occasional maintenance. It does burn slightly more methane. But from a resource standpoint, this thing is super cheap compared to 63 of those other turbines. And let's just face it, it looks cool, doesn't it? And these rotors last forever, and these things don't break down that much. So in the case of the gas turbine, I think it's actually worth it. If you're going to have that much methane to spare, why not build one of these things? Just make sure you put it somewhere where you can see the turbine blade spinning, and bear in mind that the spaces in front of this turbine blade have to be open. You can't have anything in front of these or it'll block the turbine and it won't work. So, That is the large gas turbine. Very cool, and it's actually not that inefficient. So, but now it's time to get to the one that everyone's been waiting for, right? This is probably why you're watching this video. We're going to do the fusion reactor. The fusion reactor is stupidly expensive. It requires a ton of these advanced machine casings, a ton of these fusion coils. It also requires one fusion control computer, at least 4 fusion energy injectors, up to 16, at least 2 fusion material injectors, and at least 1 fusion material extractor. Now, you can put more than 2 fusion material injectors in, you can put more than 1 fusion material extractor in, but only 1 reaction will work on this thing at a time, so having any more than this is just kind of pointless. The only thing that you would put these in here for is if you want to avoid making an extra advanced machine casing, and considering these things take highly advanced machine blocks anyway, why would you? So, yeah. To start out with your advanced casings, do 3, 2, 1. 2, 3, 2, 1. 2, 3, 2, 1. 2, 3, 2, 1, 2. On each one of these advanced casings, you put a fusion coil. I'm recording. Okay. On top of all of these, you also put advanced machine casings. I'm not going to put one here for a reason. I'm also going to break this one out for a reason. You'll see in a little bit. All right. Centered on one side, on the inside of the fusion coil, you put your fusion control computer. Somewhere on top of the 3 spots, to one side or the other of the middle, you put a fusion material injector above and below the coil. Somewhere on the 3s, to the inside or the outside, on one of these 2 blocks here, you put your fusion material extractor. In the corners here, where you have this one thing spitting or sticking out here, this is where you put your fusion energy injectors. You can put them on the inside and the outside. This one, it is actually worth it to put 16 on here. And then anywhere else you see a coil exposed, you put an advanced machine casing. And that is a complete fusion reactor. The only thing we need to do, if we right-click this, you're going to see we have the GUI here. And I guess it'll even show up even if it's not correct. But if you have it built like this, you've done it right. You have to be able to supply energy into the fusion energy injectors. Now, it seems like the superconductors are bugged in this version of Gregtech. They don't seem to want to work. So, glass fiber will work. Now, bear in mind that these things can only take, or they can only take 8,192 per tick. They can take quad extreme voltage, but they can't take anything more than that. So you have to be careful about how you're infusing your energy into these. You can infuse it directly from one IDSU. Don't try to infuse any more than that. It's not going to work too well. There we go. Now, how I'm going to do this is I'm going to get some plasma generators. These things output quad HV each. So these things output EV, right? We're going to put 4 plasma generators. Like that. And we're going to connect each one of these plasma generators to a set of coils. Oops. Now, what I'm doing here is overkill. I'm doing this only to charge the system so you guys can actually see it working. In reality, you probably won't need any more than 4 plasma generators to make this thing operate. Probably not even that. I'll show you the reactions in a minute here. Now, there we go. And we're going to give each one of these a charge of helium plasma. Plasma generators produce 2048 EU per tick running on helium plasma. It is going to take just a minute to get these things running. So, I apologize, but I wanted to show the building of it, not just the operation. Okay. Get ourselves another stack. And you can see that the helium plasma produces 4,096,000 EU for each one of these helium plasma cells. These things are ridiculous. 4 million EU from a single helium plasma cell. And last one. Okay, so what is this doing? Well, we are charging the energy injectors in order to put charge into the fusion reactor. The fusion reactor has 4 different reactions. You can fuse. Let me pull up the recipes here real quick. You can fuse deuterium and tritium to get helium plasma. You can fuse deuterium and helium-3 to get helium plasma. You can fuse lithium and wolframium, which is tungsten, to get iridium dust. Or you can fuse beryllium and wolframium to get platinum. I don't know why you would do the platinum reaction. It seemed kind of stupid to me, as common as platinum is, but whatever. Each one of these lists a start EU and an EU per tick. It also lists a certain amount of ticks and a total amount of EU required for the reaction. So, to create 1 helium plasma out of deuterium and tritium, it takes 524,288 EU. But, to kickstart this reaction, it takes 40 million. So, if you aren't planning on making at least 10 helium plasma cells, you are actually going to spend, or actually more than like 12, 13 helium plasma cells, you are going to spend more creating the reaction than you're going to get back out of it. So bear in mind, it's best to do these reactions when you have tons of materials available. Let's see. And that is true for each one of these reactions. Alright guys, sorry about that. Hearing ow, 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 ow from the other room is usually a good cause to take a short break. So, let's get back into it. No. How do you create the helium plasma? Come on, how do you create helium plasma? That's what we need to know. Okay, so the second reaction that creates helium plasma is deuterium and helium 3, which you get from centrifuging and stuff. This one costs 60 million to start, so it costs more than the deuterium-tritium recipe, but the cost to create each cell is only half. So if you're going to be producing a lot of helium plasma out of helium 3, it's better to use this recipe for your deuterium. If you have access to that much endstone, save a bunch of helium 3 and do it this way, because you're going to get more power benefit out of this. The iridium recipe costs 150 million EU to start, and then it costs 16,777,000 to produce. So, this produces iridium though. So if you have tons of lithium and wolframium saved up, once you get past that initial 150 million EU, this is actually a fairly efficient way to produce iridium, considering producing it out of UU matter these days is horribly expensive. This actually isn't bad. So save up a couple of stacks of this stuff and sure, make yourself a bunch of iridium. And we have full injectors, so we have 160 million stored in here. Let's go ahead and make ourselves some iridium. It takes lithium and wolframium. So, in one of the infusion material injectors, we're going to put our lithium. In the other one, we're going to put our wolframium. And that is going to immediately kickstart the reaction. It's going to burn off almost all of the EU we had in the injectors, and it's going to start producing in the material extractor after a set amount of time. Where is it? Come on. Give it. Give it. Give it. There we go. We have iridium dust. It's going to cost us about 15 million EU, which it's going to pull at 32,768 EU per tick, which means you're going to have a setup kind of like what I have here in order to do this. You're going to want a bunch of plasma generators feeding directly into the fusion energy injectors in order to support this reaction, because we're barely supporting this reaction. But if you do this, you can make yourself some iridium dust. Pretty neat, huh? So this is how you build and operate a fusion reactor. Like I said, if you're doing iridium, you're going to want to have the 16 plasma generators on here feeding in, kind of like how I have it here. If you're not doing that many, this is overkill. Most of these reactions to produce the helium-3 cost, see, 4,096 EU per tick on that one, 2,048. So in order to be able to power this thing to support these reactions, you would only need like four or six of these fusion energy injectors. You would only need one or two plasma generators feeding into them to power the entire reaction. So what I've done here is kind of overkill. This is an iridium producing fusion reactor is what it is. If you're just going to be using it to create power and you don't really care about the iridium, you can save yourself some time by not building as many of these energy injectors, by only having a couple plasma generators running on it. So, pros to the fusion reactor. It produces redonkulous amounts of power. I mean, these helium plasma cells, when you're using these reactions, it's 128 ticks to produce a helium plasma cell. So about every 6.5 seconds, you're getting a helium plasma cell, which is worth 4 million EU, which these plasma generators will burn off at 2,000 EU per tick. So these things produce ridiculous amounts of power, and it's actually not terribly difficult to get the materials to run it every once in a while. Automating it to run full-time, that's a different story, and that is what we're going to cover in Gregtech 104. In Gregtech 104, we are going to start out with a pre-built fusion reactor, kind of like this, and then we are going to build hopefully from scratch, although in creative mode, we're going to build the power network that it would take to run this thing on a deuterium-tritium reaction infinitely. So, that's going to be a hell of an undertaking, isn't it? But it ought to be a lot of fun to see. Anyway, hopefully this has given you guys a better feeling on exactly what the pros and cons for the multi-block Gregtech reactors are. Not a huge fan of the steam reactor. The gas turbine, if you have that much methane, sure, it's worth it. The fusion reactor, oh hell yeah. If you can afford one of these things, build it. These things are just too cool, they look awesome, and they produce so much power that you'll never be hurting for power ever again. And what's better than one fusion reactor? Two fusion reactors. So, this has been Night Dagger with How the Heck Do I Gregtech 103, the multi-block reactors. Hopefully you guys learned something, and I'll catch you later, peeps.